difference is the team. You know, the Marlboro Team Penske is just a super race team, and they've designed a great car, Nigel Bennett back in England, and you know, Roger Penske just drives these guys really hard, and it's great. It's great to be part of it.
All right, Al Unser Jr. starts on the pole as we have a unique opportunity to talk to a number of the drivers. Derek?
Paul, I had hoped to speak live with Nigel Mansell about the question that's on everybody's mind at the moment, Formula One, will he or won't he? He refused to talk to us because he really didn't want any distractions prior to getting ready to go to battle against Al Unser Jr. and the rest of the Penske team in an effort to retain his PPG IndyCar World Series title. However, this is what I do know. Nigel will do all the remaining IndyCar races. He will do all the remaining IndyCar tests that are scheduled. However, speculation is rife that on Tuesday he will be in England testing the Williams Formula One car, and that he would compete next weekend at the French Grand Prix. Gary?
Back here in row five, Derek, we have Michael Andretti, of course, no stranger to this circuit. He's won here three times in the past, missed last year's race competing in Formula One, won the season opener in Australia. I know you're struggling to find the balance you want in this race car. Is it frustrating being here in row five as opposed to being in the front couple of rows?
Well, obviously, we'd love to be up in the front couple of rows, but, you know, we're just working at it. We're trying to understand this car, and we're having a little bit of a struggle with it, but... Every race we just hang in there, and I think that's been the key to this team, this whole Target team. They've just been getting us in and out of pits quick and giving us a reliable car. We've been scoring points, and if we don't have a competitive car, if we can keep scoring points, we'll be there in the end for the championship. So that's the key thing right now.
Keep in mind, this is the only other team than the Penske team that's won this year. Jan Bikas.
Well, Gary, certainly one of the hard chargers this year has been Robbie Gordon. And Robbie, one of your sponsors is No Fear. Does Robbie Gordon have no fear?
Well, you know, like you said earlier, confidence definitely takes over the fear. But sometimes, you know, you got to have fear to finish these races. And, you know, the Valvoline team, Walker, they've just been doing a great job. You know, the car's been strong, and we've been consistent.
Nigel Mansell would not talk about Formula One, but will you talk about Winston Cup? What does NASCAR hold for Robbie Gordon's future?
Well, we had a deal to run two races this year. We're going to run probably the Brickyard, and then I don't know what's going to happen next year.
Well, he's confident. He's ready to start from the inside of row number four.
Well, Jimmy Vassar is one of those drivers that has had a quiet but a spectacular season thus far. Jimmy, out of the six races we won, have run thus far, three times you have been in the top five. What's the change this year?
Well, we've got new equipment. The Hayhoe Racing team is doing a great job. All the mechanics involved are really working their butts off, and we've got a lot more money. It takes a lot of money, Paul, to do this, and we've got a great group of sponsors in Conseco, STP, Vital Care Hair Care Products, and Shiloh Inns is a local sponsor here in Portland. Looking forward to doing good for them today, and it just takes a lot of money, a lot of hard work. It's very competitive. We've had our ups and our downs. Fortunately, we've had some top fives, and maybe we can get another one today.
It looks like this track gives you plenty of room to race.
Yeah, it's the first permanent road circuit we've been on all year, and we love the ovals, Indianapolis Motor Speedway. The street circuits are a little bit tedious, but they're nice to be in the cities. But this is our first permanent road course, and I think if you went up and down the pit lane and asked the drivers, they'd all pretty much say they enjoy being here.
Well, I know you're anxious to get back to your car, so thanks for joining the time with us. Let's go to Gary.
In the second row, Paul Tracy looking for his second consecutive victory, and Paul is already, as you can see, just finished buckling up in the cockpit, ready to go as he goes after a second straight. We talked to him earlier today about how tough it was after coming off the podium 2 weeks ago at Detroit to go face his teammate in the cruise after that bumping incident. You heard Junior talk about it. Paul said yes, he accepted the apology, offered his hand, and he says everything's cool right now. He's all dismissed that from his mind, and right now he is thinking about only one thing, a second consecutive victory and a further climb in the PPG IndyCar World Championship point standings. Jan?
Well, Gary, actually, this is the time that a driver is most nervous. As he's putting on the helmet, as he's putting on the gloves, and then the crew reaches in to buckle him into the car, certainly in the case here of Raul Boisel. Now, when the engines fire, so does the heart rate go up. These drivers are never really comfortable until they actually roll away from the grid. Paul?
Well, the drivers are now beginning to climb in their cars. There's another star here in all of these stories, Derek, and that is that Nigel Bennett-designed Penske chassis.
I do think you have to give Nigel Bennett a lot of credit for the success of Penske this year. This chassis definitely seems to preserve its rear tires more than any other IndyCar here. Now, on new, fresh tires for practice or qualifying, you can actually mask some handling difficulties with that fresh tire. However, 15, 20, 25 laps into the race on full tanks, that is when the Penske maintains its momentum and everybody else seems to drop off. So the rear tires are critical and they're excellent on the Penske after 25 laps.
And then, too, the championship battle is now beginning to take shape. As we approach the halfway point in the season, there are six races behind us. 1,374 racing miles have gone by. The Indy cars have traveled a tough and winding trail. It began in the land down under. Michael Andretti's return from Formula One netted a win for the new Renard. The PPG points lead. But perhaps the most important item of all, a podium finish with his father. In the Arizona desert, the car builder's devotion to safety paid off. The crash was frightening. The injury, slight. Emerson Fittipaldi took the win in the Penske chassis, a prediction of things to come. On Long Beach streets, it was another Penske displaying remarkable cornering and giving Al Unser Jr. his first win for Roger. This new partnership could lead to years of victory. Indy always holds surprises with its blinding speed and narrow straightaway. This year was no different. Emerson Fittipaldi put an untested Mercedes engine in the lead until this in the closing lap. But that only passed the torch to Junior for his second Indy win. At the Milwaukee Mile, it was the Nigel Bennett-designed Penske's 1, 2, 3. But now with Elmore power, Al was on top and had a firm grip on the points lead. 2 weeks ago in the Motor City, Penske teammates Tracy and Unser fought for the lead. Al lost to finish 10th. Paul Tracy scored the win. Portland is now the key that could unlock the IndyCar Championship. Today's coverage of the IndyCars from Portland is brought to you by the all-new Ford Mustang. It is what it was and more. And by Quaker State, the intelligent oil for longer engine life. Welcome back to Portland and the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200, where we take a look at how they line up for today's race. On the pole is Al Unser Jr. with a new track record. His first IndyCar win came here in 1984. Alongside is Nigel Mansell, his third front row start of the season. All of those have come on road courses. In row two, it's Emerson Fittipaldi, who won in the rain last year to become a two-time Portland winner. And Paul Tracy, who makes his second Portland start. In row three, it's Jacques Villeneuve, who has finished in the top nine in his last three races. Alongside is Jimmy Vassar with three top five finishes in 94. The fourth row, Robbie Gordon with five top seven finishes in 94. And Mauricio Gugelmann, who has started in the top eight in all four road races this year. Row five is Michael Andretti, the Portland winner in his last three starts here. And Teo Fabi, the 1989 Portland pole winner. Row six is Brian Herta, who finished in the top 10 in all three of his IndyCar starts. And Raul Boisel, who has failed to finish only twice in seven starts at Portland. In row seven, Stefan Johansson and Adrian Fernandez. The eighth row, Dominic Dobson and Mario Andretti. Row nine, Bobby Rahal and Scott Sharp. The 10th row, Scott Goodyear and Mike Groff. Row 11, Alessandro Zampedri and Mark Smith. Row 12, Willie T. Ribbs and Robbie Groff. Ari Leyendyke is in row 13 along with Marco Greco. In row 14, Parker Johnstone making his first start ever in an IndyCar and Frank Freon. Row 15, Buddy Lazier and Hiro Matsushita. And row 16, Ross Bentley and Jeff Wood.
And Jeff Wood helps make up the largest starting field for IndyCars ever here in Portland. Now, the first corner they must negotiate is also one of the most difficult. It's the Festival Chicane. Jan Beekhuis is down there.
That's right, Derek. In a matter of moments, all 32 IndyCars will come down here and bundle through the festival curves. The first thing they have to worry about is going from asphalt to concrete, the concrete being much more slippery than the asphalt itself. Then a left-hand turn where they go down to 35 miles per hour. This is also a great place to pass, so you brake just as late as you possibly can. But if you brake too late, like Nigel Mansell did last year, and actually shortcut the chicane, a driver has to stop at the stop sign, then wait for the green light from a turn worker, because if you don't, you'll get a stop-and-go penalty. Paul?
So we're now ready as the IndyCar sits silent for the moment for that most famous command. And with a special watch, here's Gary Gerrell.
Great day for Portland. We're all very, very excited.
We await for that command, Paul, the traditional words, and you'll hear a roar that'll go up on the opposite side of this racetrack on the grandstand side. These crews poised and ready. We're back in row six alongside Raul Boisel's car. Larry Zalesnik will be handling the starter, and he patiently is waiting now as we anticipate the words.
Drivers, start your engines.
And there they are, the command to start engines. So, starter is engaged. They're waiting for a moment. Now they crank the engine over. And the engine roars to life for Raul Boisel. No superstitions for Raul back here. Only the fact that he gets into the race car from the right side. Each of the specialists, you just may have seen Luke Wethington, one of the tire men, tapping the right front wheel. Raul now stealing the concentration. A quick thumbs up from the cockpit. Morris Nunn, who's been with this team this season, has parted company with Dick Simon. So his engineering expertise is gone. Simon now handles the engineering responsibilities for this crew. Fourth place at Long Beach, the best finish this year for Raul Boisel. Four times in his career, he's been second. He knows it's tough to challenge the Penske's, the Newman-Haas team. He'll do it today from row six as we get ready to get this field rolling momentarily, Paul.
So the entire field indicates that they are ready to roll, and when we come back, the Indy cars will be ready to race in the Budweiser G.I. Joe 200. Behind the PPG pace cars, the field circles this course here at Portland, the pace car itself being driven by Gordon Johncock, the great Indianapolis champion. There was a lot of controversy over Allinger Jr. being bumped by Paul Tracy at Detroit. Now, for the players or for the act itself, it was not the first time. It has been written, it's not whether you win or lose, but how you play the game.
Yeah, right. You don't think he'd have done it to me? There you have it. Arrivederci, Mario. So much for five in a row. That's twice. No comment. Yeah, right.
Allinger Jr., who probably ought to remain a racer and not go into stand-up comedy. But he is the pole sitter, a record pole here today as the field lines up now. The first of the parade laps is complete. Nigel Mansell moves into position and begins to scrub tires down here today as we are ready with a gigantic field set to go for the 200-mile run here at Portland. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Paul, if you remember back to the mid-80s, I think it was 1986, Father's Day, coming to the checkered flag, Michael Andretti running out of fuel, losing to his dad by 0.07 of a second. This racetrack has always been notoriously tough on fuel limitations, and that's a major concern today, the biggest concern of any race thus far this season. As for the pit window, it's very precise. Jan Beekes, when do we expect those first stops?
Well, Gary, you have to look at this as a 102-lap race. They can only go 34 laps on fuel. That splits it evenly in three 34-lap sections. Of course, they have warm-up laps right now, so you'll probably see them pitting on lap 33. Then you have to stretch at 34, possibly 35, to make it a two-stop race. They have plenty of fuel, but they want to stop only twice. Paul?
It makes for some precise handling from the pits as well as the drivers. Take a look at the track here at Portland. 1.95 miles around, 102 laps our scheduled distance, 9 turns, and going the reverse direction of most U.S. road courses.
And one of the great things about this track here at Portland, you'll see it during the afternoon, it retains a lot of the character of the old days. Lots of green grass and lots of trees. But the double apex corners, particularly in the infield, are critical to handling. You must turn in. Here's a good look here at some of those double apex corners that your car must handle properly to be quick over the long haul of 2 hours of racing.
And as Jimmy Vassar suggested earlier, one of the good parts of this track is that there is plenty of room, as you can see there, in the first set of corners after the festival chicane. So you can drive a little more flat out, 110% if that's what it is. 189.9 miles today. The pit stop, as Jan told us, right after lap 32, but probably not later than lap 34. It's very precise. And the weather? Well, there is a possibility of some shower activity in the area. Dark clouds lie off the edges of the speedway, but right now it looks like we're going to get 200 miles in without any rain whatsoever. Let's hope that's true. The field circulates through now and will go into order very shortly here. Gordon Johncock in the pace car picks up the pace a bit, and they begin to align into their rows of two. Pace car accelerates. Nigel pulls in alongside Little Al. Tracy and Fittipaldi just behind. Villeneuve, Vassar just behind that. Now off that final sweeping turn, they look at the pit straight, the front straight for the first time, and they watch for a green flag. There it is. Everybody on the brakes for the first set of corners.
And Alonso Jr. was not going to be surprised by a run by Mansell. You clearly saw him accelerate as soon as he got onto that front straight. Look at the traffic jam here.
Jammed up in the chicane, but now they begin to string off. It looks like everybody is through safely. The one car straggling on the outside of the corner there. We'll check that one for you as we take a look at the front of the field with Alonso Jr. pulling away. Willie T. Ribbs already in trouble in that first corner. No indication as to what. No obvious damage on the car. We'll keep track of Willie T. Al Unser Jr. pulls away. Nigel Mansell is in pursuit. On the backstretch for the first time.
Mansell needed to try and get ahead of Al Unser Jr. Try and get track position and use it to his advantage. He knows if Al Jr.'s ahead, like he is now, it can be a long, long, hard fight.
Nigel Mansell with much to prove here, the defending IndyCar champion. Classic battle between he and Fittipaldi in and out of the rain last year. Finally resolved in Fittipaldi's favor when Mansell slid off at the end of this straightaway here. Now he's in close pursuit of Little Al.
And you mentioned a classic battle. We had a titanic struggle yesterday during one of the best qualifying sessions I have seen for a long time between Al Jr., that was Willie T's car, between Al Jr. and Mansell. Took the pole position from each other. Mansell's team was celebrating, and on the very last lap that Al Jr. put in, he grabbed the pole back. It was spectacular.
Fittipaldi is third, Tracy is fourth, Robbie Gordon is fifth. Let's take a look at the start from the blimp overhead as Mansell moved to the outside. And look how fast they have to break down into that corner. Look at the compression there.
Oh, look at Villeneuve. Goes over the curb on the inside. Look at the squeeze job there, and everybody gets away with it.
Well, at the same time, Vassar got right inside of Michael Andretti. Exciting start here, but now resolved very much in favor of Al Unser Jr. as the Penske cars of Fittipaldi and Tracy close on the Newman Haas Lola of Nigel Mansell.
And an unusual sight of Al Jr. leading away from the pole. Five times in 10 years is all he's managed to do that, be on the pole. A staggering statistic when you consider his success ratio. But he may be an even better racing driver now with Team Penske than he ever was in the past. What a thought.
IndyCar safety team trying to get Willie T. Ribbs' stricken vehicle off the edge of the road as we watch his teammate, Robbie Gordon, who runs in fifth place. Villeneuve is just behind him. Jacques had a spectacular year as well. And then Jimmy Vassar, then Michael Andretti, then Brian Herta and Mauricio Guzmán.
Watching Gordon here, the Ford engine says he's matured so much his driving style has changed. Last year he was on the rev limiter all the time, broke the wheels away at the back on wheel spin. Now he said he uses much more torque in this engine, a lot less gear change, and thinks that smoother style saves the tires and makes him a faster driver overall.
The report from IndyCar is that Willie T cannot get his car back into neutral. But couldn't they at least bump start it and get him going and then figure it out at the first pit stop?
Yes, unless he has a clutch problem. Look what we have here, Paul. Remember last year? Fittipaldi pressured and pressured and dogged Mansell until he made him make a mistake. Let's watch to see if something similar happen.
Mansell with pressure really from both sides as Allanser Jr. pulls away and Fittipaldi pursues from behind. The rest of the order comes through. Still in close contact at the front of the field. In fact, very close contact all the way through 10th position.
Here's the drag race down the back straight, or the back curve. It is flat. It's almost 185 miles an hour here in qualifying. And this corner here, the left-hander, is a blindingly fast. Down one gear and blast on the power. This here is one of the slow second-gear corners.
Allanser Jr. has picked the pace up each lap. This last lap, his fastest, at 111.8 miles an hour. His first lap was at 108. He's just been steadily climbing. On board, Nigel Mansell.
Watch his outside wheels, how close they go to the curb. One gear change. Third gear.
Watch the curve now at the end of this curving backstretch. Yeah, he uses a few feet of that.
All the way up on the curve on the left-hand side. Now here's the drag race. Down this front straight. 175 miles an hour on full tanks even.
And the frustrating part is that no matter how far he looks ahead, he can barely see Allanser Jr., who is pulling away steadily, now nearly 4 seconds ahead of second place Nigel Mansell. So the race is underway here, and it is Allanser Jr. that runs in full in front of Mansell. Back at the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200 from Portland International Raceway, Allanser Jr. runs in front, car 31, with a solid lead over the second place car of 4.5 seconds. There's second place, Nigel Mansell, who is being pursued by Emerson Fittipaldi and then by Paul Tracy.
Now this is a good battle. We mentioned earlier the battle with Allanser Jr. in qualifying. It's amazing how calm they are. Roger Penske told us a very amusing story last night that Al Jr., when he knew he wasn't on the pole, he said, give me one more lap. And as he started it, he got on his radio and said, here I come, here it goes. And he pulled it off, got the pole.
On board Michael Andretti, Jimmy Vassar smokes the brakes going into the festival chicane as Michael tries to close in. We'll stay right here. This is a battle for seven.
2 Reynard chassis here. Watch Vassar's right front. There it is. Locks it up. Out of control. Michael over the curb in the target Scotch Reynard.
Michael Andretti jumped the curb on both sides. The Reynards have already proven in his win at Surfer's Paradise how really strong they are. So you can hop the curbs with them, but I wonder how long you can.
And isn't it amazing, Paul, that Michael has not been able to repeat that? He was so dominant so quickly in Australia. Very frustrated. He chases more grip in this car. I spoke to Mike Hull afterwards, and he said the one thing they work on for Michael is to give him more rear grip in particular, because he said he is an all-out power driver, jumps on the power and wants the rear of the car to support his actions.
Another unique view that we have is Brian Herta closes in behind Michael and Mauricio Guzelman just behind Herta now. But this view right here, camera mounted on the side plate of the wing, if you look at the relationship of the right rear tire just in front of you to the chassis itself, it really gives you an idea of the roll rate of the car.
Oh, this is a great camera shot here. Now watch the left-hander. Watch them lean into it. Leans in. And the suspension comes up. Wait till you see when it hits a curb. But Vassar is quick through here. See Vassar in the Conseco Reynard, 4 or 5 car lengths ahead. But under braking, Michael seems to just edge a little bit closer.
Look at Brian Herta. Boy, he's getting an education in A.J. Foyt's car following these two.
Willie T. Ribbs, by the way, was able to get restarted and is back in the action, though we're not sure if he was able to totally solve his gearbox problem. Brian Herta runs in ninth place. Grugelman in tenth. Let's go pit side and Jan.
Well, Paul, there's already been a lot of radio communications going on in the Penske pit, as well as many pits up and down. Everyone is already turning their fuel meters inside the car all the way to the lean position. Some of these cars only got 1.47 miles per gallon in qualifying. Now they have to get 1.8. Roger Penske is one of those who's been telling his drivers, okay, let's turn that fuel, let's get it maximized early.
Remember, CART always gives you enough fuel to finish the race if you do 1.8 miles to the gallon. That's the magic number.
Allanser Jr. pulled the lap off at 112 as we watch Dominic Dobson get off for just a moment. 112.9, and then slowed it down a bit after that. He's brought his pace down just a little bit the last couple laps. Back to the Jimmy Vassar-Michael Andretti battle.
Great fight here. This is where Michael likes to close up. Remember, at the Festival of Curves, he dives down under braking. He's too far behind. He's not going to do it this time. See, Michael has the old helmet strap on the right side there, down under his shoulder. Look at this!
Whoa, Michael hits him! Michael tries to get inside Jimmy Vassar. Vassar closes the door. Michael's minus a left front. Jimmy Vassar stopped in the sand trap.
Way too ambitious for Michael to come from that far behind. The car is so badly damaged, he will not drive that back to the pits without severe damage. Here it is. Big lunge under braking. Watch Vassar turn in. There's the impact. That was a very ambitious move by Michael, which just didn't come off. Look, he was probably six car lengths behind. Not enough room. End of the day, Vassar and Michael.
Well, you said, Derek, on the straightaway itself that Michael was not nearly close enough.
Looked way too ambitious. Now, he hopes Vassar sees him and gives him all the room he needs. Right now, he knows he's in trouble. Nowhere to go. Look at Vassar, 3 feet into the air.
Do you think Vassar ever saw him?
Or certainly he didn't know he was at the apex, or else he would have tried to give him some room. Now, is Vassar's car damaged, or can he get that going back? We know how strong the Reinhardt is. We saw Michael bounce off everything in sight in Australia. Here's the in-car. Whoa.
Hard to believe that Vassar doesn't have serious damage as well. And look how close Herta was to getting tagged by Michael on the exit of the chicane.
So Brian Herta goes from ninth to seventh without actually having to make a brave move himself.
With all that kind of damage, why is Michael even trying to drive it back?
Saves him having to walk.
No other reason at all.
Unless he thinks he can get it repaired, which I doubt, because he's losing way too much time. Very unfortunate for Jimmy Vassar in the Conseco car as he sits there. He's now on the gravel trap, going to lose way too much time. But Michael is definitely on a wing and a prayer here.
Well, Michael Andretti limps back to the pits with no real chance of having that car repaired. It remains static at the front with Allanser Jr. leading Nigel Mansell now by nearly 7 seconds. Back at Portland with a very frustrated Michael Andretti as he talks to Chip Ganassi, his car owner, and tries to explain what happened down there. At the same time, IndyCar officials are trying to get Jimmy Vassar back onto the road. And Derek, that car may be intact. There's some damage there, but that's not terminal kind of stuff, is it?
I wouldn't think so. Now, if they can fire him up.
Here's the side we want to see, is what the left side. And it looks pretty good.
And he didn't fire it up. So for whatever reason, he didn't want to fire it up then and drive it all the way back. Look, he's asked them to have a look around,
yep,
make sure the thing's okay. If there is damage, he doesn't want to make it even more serious.
He just knows when he looked to the right, Michael was down below him, and he has no idea what damage may exist behind him. So now we're back watching Nigel Mansell, who is receiving a lot of pressure from Emerson Fittipaldi, with Paul Tracy closing in too.
Totally different line there by Emerson. Much wider on the top of the hill left-hander. Paul Tracy follows Emerson. Tracy, we were surprised really that he didn't have a good crack at the pole, but oh, look at this. Emerson is quicker. He's beginning to show his nose to Mansell. The pressure and the heat is beginning to get turned up here on Nigel Mansell.
And it looks like this battle will take us to the chicane. Let's see if Fittipaldi can position for a maneuver inside the chicane. He holds back.
See, Mansell watched the mirrors. He looked left, looked right, wanted to know exactly where Emerson was, and he knew he wasn't going to have a shot at him.
All right, let's get an update from the pits, Jan.
Michael, what happened out there between you and Vassar?
Well, I was attempting a pass because he was really holding me up, and he went way wide. I thought there was something wrong with him because he was over by the wall, and I almost thought he was letting me by. When I went to the inside, the next thing you know, I saw him out of the corner of my eye, and we hit, and I hit him, I think, right behind his right front with my left front, and that was it. I wish he would have given me about 2 feet of room, and we would have been all right.
Now, his team owner, Jim Hayhoe, was just here, and he talked to you. What did he say?
I don't know. He just said something about watch it on TV or something. So I'll look at it. But it was a racing accident, and I thought he saw me and he didn't, and it was really unfortunate.
Thanks, Mike.
Paul.
When he went in, Vassar did seem to come way wide. This is not really a telling picture because you have Jimmy Vassar sitting to the left side. Michael certainly had a line into the corner, but it intersected with Vassar's line because of the sweep Vassar was using.
Right, and it looked like Michael's left front wheel made contact with just ahead of the right rear of Vassar's, and that's where we saw the bodywork damage as he got towed out of the gravel trap. Watch it here. Watch the point of impact. Now, Vassar does move wide. That's what led Michael to believe maybe he's letting him through. Then suddenly he turns. There's the point of impact. Vassar's right rear drives over Michael's left front, and that was all she wrote.
So on the race course itself now, as Michael Andretti is out, and we still wait for the final word on the fate of Jimmy Vassar, Emerson Fittipaldi still is putting the pressure on Nigel Mansell as we take a look from high above this course.
Mansell has been consistently the fastest Lola. His car is engineered by Peter Gibbons, who looked after Michael Andretti to such success a couple of years ago. I spoke to Peter. He said they really have done a lot of mechanical changes on the car, development, ongoing developments, but aerodynamically not near as much as mechanical side. Peter Gibbons, incidentally, thinks that the Lola is in fact a better racing car than the Reynard.
Watching from high above Portland International from the Blockbuster Video blimp, part of the 1994 tour through the western half of the United States. We welcome the Blockbuster Video blimp and its crew today to the broadcast and those great pictures they're giving us from just over the track. Interesting comparison of these two cars and how they perform differently in different sections of the course, especially when viewed from above.
Certainly under acceleration, Fittipaldi does not seem to be a threat to Mansell. In other words, he can't quite get close enough on these drag runs down the back straight. Look how far Al Unser Jr. is. 9 seconds up the road from Nigel Mansell. Is he going to hold up Emerson? Is Nigel holding up Emerson? Certainly doesn't look like it. I would have thought Emerson, if he was a lot quicker, would have made a challenging lunge at Mansell before now.
Paul Tracy waits stationed in the same proximate position just behind Fittipaldi, followed by Gordon, then Villeneuve, then Herta, Guzelmin, Fabi, and Bosel round out the top 10 with the absence now of Vassar and Michael Andretti.
And Robbie Gordon is still hanging on there. He is at the end of this group of four cars here. Watch the curb again on the inside as we watch Mansell drive up over the top. That's the only non-FIA curbing here. The infield all has FIA curb, which is just like Formula One. It's a very high curb, but that
now,
one you can drive over.
Now, though, we have slower traffic just ahead. Is this going to set an opportunity for Fittipaldi to make a move as, again, they head for the Festival chicane?
Oh, yeah. Oh, now. What are we, 19 laps into it? Mansell now beginning to get in trouble. This is almost an identical situation to last year, and that was where he had trouble. That was where he spun, and Fittipaldi finally got by after pressuring him for so long. That's Parker Johnstone in the new team just ahead of him, another one of the Honda cars.
His first time on the racetrack as Fittipaldi continues his pursuit of Nigel Mansell, and Al Unser Jr. is pulling away from the field at 9.8. Back in Portland as Nigel Mansell continues to try to hold off Fittipaldi. They have Hero to deal with at the moment, but Tracy is now beginning to worry Fittipaldi. That was Scott Sharp, who was just off the edge of the course at the beginning of the Festival chicane.
And you know what I just saw? Nigel Mansell passed Matt Schuster under yellow. He definitely, I looked up, the yellow flags were flying, and Mansell did pass Matt Schuster.
Now that brings us to a whole new question. After the controversy that they had over waving a driver by at Detroit, the IndyCar officials have now said you can no longer wave somebody else by. If you do, you might as well wave the whole field.
Watch the yellow flag on the left-hand side. There's the pass. Yellow flag, left-hand side. There she goes. Hey, baby, oh, we got a black flag.
But where did the yellow zone start? Was the pass completed at it, before it, just beyond it? That's what they pay Wally Dallenbach for.
Wally Dallenbach, he may have another headache to sort out here. Now Fittipaldi sails past Matt Schuster. Matt Schuster really needs to move aside and let this leading group ahead.
Oh, and he does.
That's the way to move aside.
That's a way to do it.
Can he hear me?
Robbie Gordon stays in contact with Tracy as well. They're the top five for you, though we're not seeing much of the lead car, Al Unser Jr., and that's because he's 13 seconds ahead now of second place Nigel Mansell.
Of course, what's going on here is exactly what Al Unser Jr. wants. While they squabble and fight among themselves, Jr. has clear road, and he just stretches it and inches it further and further away, bringing him back to possibly what Jan Beeke said earlier on, maybe having enough control in this race to actually do a two-stop race instead of three.
As we watch this ongoing battle between Fittipaldi and Mansell, Gary Gerald has this update.
A couple of observations from the Newman Haas and Penske pits that are adjacent to each other, Paul. Emerson Fittipaldi pressuring, and as you've mentioned, much reminiscent of what happened here last year, forcing Mansell into the mistake as they had to contend with rain as well as dry conditions in the course of that race. They may think, the Penske camp, that they'll be content to try to get the advantage on the pit stop at lap 33. That's 10 laps away. Meanwhile, the Mansell camp is saying, you know that when Al Unser Jr. qualifies with the race setup and now pulls away from the field, he's got everybody covered. Right now, it seems like the thinking is, who's going to be second in this race? Let's go to Jan.
Well, when we talk about how the differences are in the way they set up a Penske chassis and a Lola, the Penske chassis have great traction. So the Lolas have done this. This is a shock absorber, and if I compress this shock absorber, you can see they go onto a bump rubber. What happens is they run now the Lolas so soft to get traction that when they go down the straightaway, they rub on the ground unless they fill this up with bump rubbers. But then the car is much stiffer. Tuning these is very critical. The Lolas are running these, the Penskes are not. Does the Penske car have a different system? We don't know that for sure, but these are very important here at Portland.
Of course, Jan, that's almost like a rising rate suspension. The more you go down, the stiffer the rate suddenly shoots up when you do get onto those bump rubbers. The amazing thing about those bump rubbers is they measure them in minute increments, like a 16th of an inch, maybe just enough to change the handling of these very, very precisely set up racing cars.
But the bump rubber itself does have some spring rate to it.
No, not the bump rubber. Oh, yes, the actual rubber part of it does. When you slide in the stiff ones, they don't actually have any movement.
Marco Greco moves aside as little Al moves inside.
Well, Al Jr. is having such a good time here. He wasn't spectacular in testing. He wasn't spectacular in Australia. Took a bit of time to learn the system, learn the ropes, learn the team and the car. But boy, he has come on so strong so quickly here that now people are virtually conceding the championship to Al Unser Jr.
Ari Leyendyk runs 20th now as he tries to catch Robbie Groff back in an Indy car, and it's good to see Robbie back. Al Unser Jr. still trying to now work his way through the back of the field. And he's doing this as we begin to close on the pit stop window. We're at 25 laps. They could stop as early as 32, possibly as late as 34. But precision on the pit stop is mandatory if you're going to win this race. You have to get in and get out and do it on exactly the right lap, because fuel can be at a premium here. We've had no full course yellows, so fuel is burning away pretty quickly.
And if you're waiting to try and beat somebody by having better pit stops, you better not think you'll beat the Penske's crew, because they are so well drilled and practiced at pit stops. They do it as good, if not better, than everybody else. Look at Leyendijk. Checks his mirrors, see where Junior is, and he turns in ahead of him. Leyendijk had a terrible weekend. In fact, he said it was a disaster in the pit notes. Never really got on the pace, struggled all the time. This is a 94 Lola with a D version Ilmor engine, but this weekend, not near the pace.
Well, Al Unser Jr. for the moment is unchallenged, though this run through the slower cars in the field is definitely taking its toll on the lead. It's eroded 4 seconds off of his lead over Nigel Mansell, who now runs 9 seconds behind, and Fittipaldi continues to try and pursue Mansell. We'll be back. Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200, and there's some action going on here. Emerson Fittipaldi was able to get around Nigel Mansell on a turn going into the festival chicane, and then on the next lap, Paul Tracy, who you see just in front of Mansell, really fought with Mansell for the corner and finally won. We'll have replays on both of those for you, but what a brave move by Tracy. I mean, it looked like they were together twice, maybe three times during the corner.
And this was as good as you will get with two world-class drivers going wheel to wheel, but Tracy gets ahead. The Penske freight train, 1, 2, 3, will now, I think, pull away from Mansell. We are 29 laps into the race, and Mansell begins to experience trouble and drop back.
Down the order, there is Tracy, there is Mansell. All of them using slower traffic to their advantage, sometimes to the disadvantage of others. Certainly Tracy doing that. So Fittipaldi moves to second, Tracy to third, Mansell drops to fourth, Robbie Gordon remains in fifth. Let's take a look at the Tracy pass. Slow motion here.
This is as good as it gets. Tracy makes the move, climbs over the curb, and watch what happens here. Mansell grabs it back. And Tracy said, there's enough road for me here. Wheel to wheel, two professionals, they do not have any contact, and Tracy pulls it off as good as you will get.
Spectacular piece of driving. This is, watch to the Emerson Fittipaldi come to the inside here on the right-hand side of your screen.
This is much easier. You saw Mansell get sideways, coming onto the straight, and gave Emerson the run. He already had the corner and the line on the apex before Mansell ever turned in, and you can do nothing but concede.
It also seemed like Mansell was a little hesitant at the slower car just ahead as they entered the corner. So in second place now is the two car of Fittipaldi. Paul Tracy sits in third. The only change in the top of the order, with the exception of the fact that Teo Fabi is now beginning to poke his nose into the top 10. As we've been watching this battle, Teo has gotten around both Stefan Johansson and Raul Boisel and moves into eighth place.
And now Emerson has clear road ahead of him in his chase for Al Unser Jr. The last lap, he was 0.3 seconds faster than Al Unser Jr.'s last lap. So Emerson needs to put a charge on, but we are getting close to the first of the pit stops.
30 laps are now complete. Raul Boisel currently running in ninth place on board. And just ahead should be Teo Fabi. And as we watch this battle, Jimmy Vassar has finally made a reappearance back at the in front of the grandstand here, as walking down to the cheers of the crowd, somewhat dejected looking, along the pit straight. Delco electronic telemetry on board Raul Boisel's car as he battles with Fabi.
Almost 180 miles an hour before he got to the braking zone chasing Teo Fabi. Raul Boisel, lots of changes in the Dick Simon team. Mo Nunn, his engineer, is now gone. Dick Simon is actually Raul Boisel's engineer for this weekend, so lots of changes for Boisel, who has been so fast all through this year. Last year, for that matter. Watch the revs on the right-hand side. Look, 13-1. So you can see his, whoa, little look down the inside of Fabi. Ford engine, versus the Ilmor D.
They're all taking a pretty good chunk out of that left hand. Look at Bobby as he peels off toward the pit side. And Boissel stays on the stretch. So Bobby at lap 32 drives for the pits.
And the speed down the straight was not as fast that time as registered on the Delco Electronics, because Boissel had to back out of it just a little bit as Fabi peeled off and went down to the pit lane.
Number of cars have already taken a look at the pits. Hail Fabi one, Stefan Johansson is another. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Well, it's going to be interesting here on this first pit stop because of that fuel window is so tight. All three Penske cars will come on the same lap. Normally, they try to stagger the laps. Let's go to Jan because I think Junior is coming at him.
That's right. He's just pulled it to a stop, Gary. The first Penske car is here, and you will see in the background the other two flash by here in a moment. We're looking very closely to see if any changes are made. So far, it's just been four tires. No changes for Al. They're just waiting for the last bit of fuel. Al is underway in 14.1 as Mansell goes by. Gary?
And with Emerson Fittipaldi getting his first full service, he's ready to come off the jacks. 12, 13, 14 seconds. He's rolling. And now we look for Paul Tracy. He should be the next one coming in, just back to our left.
Mansell's completed his stop and is on the way. As they wait for Mario Andretti, there's Mark Smith coming out. And a lot of traffic where Mansell has to join.
And in fact, Paul Tracy did stay out. He has taken up the lead of the race, but we know he's on his way to the pit lane, so it's only very temporary.
First time that Paul Tracy has led here at Portland. Of course, his history here is not that long as he turns down into the pit lane. So Paul Tracy is the leader of the race, picked up on just the last lap. Comes in for his stop as well, Gary Gerald.
It certainly took away from the confusion we expected with all three cars in the same lap, but the fuel economy has been good enough that he could get it to lap 34. That could be very critical in the late stages of this race. So Tracy now getting the usual service. Boy, he's got the engine revs way up. You can hear them in the background. He is really ready to rock it when he comes off the jacks. And here he goes. Look at him light up the tires.
Tracy comes back into the fight. Take a look at the left side of the car, because I think that battle with Nigel Mansell did have a cost in terms of scrubbing off on the side pod.
I would say that is a Nigel Mansell autograph right there along the Marlboro decals on Paul Tracy's car. Thankfully, the wheels did not interlock, but that just shows you how close that tremendous pass was and that battle through the festival curves was between Tracy and Nigel Mansell.
So now 34 laps are complete. All of the leaders have completed their stops. Robbie Gordon was in and out of the pits just behind Paul Tracy. The order remains relatively unchanged as they've gone through the first series of stops in this race, which is scheduled for 102 laps. We'll be back. We're back at the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200 from Portland. Al Unser Jr. leads this race. Now Emerson Fittipaldi is up into second. Paul Tracy is third. Everything's stable after the pit stop. Nigel Mansell passed twice in two laps, is down in fourth now. Robbie Gordon is fifth. And Jacques Villeneuve runs in sixth right now. Stefan Johansson is the car that we are on board with one of those nose-mounted cams. Almost looks like a gun sight sticking out the front of the car. Stefan Johansson runs in 10th place.
And Stefan really has had a good weekend so far. Was right on the pace, particularly Saturday morning. Remember, this is one of last year's Penske chassis, the Alumax Penske PC93. So there is a bit of a disadvantage there over the later chassis. He has an Ilmor D engine, but Johansson doing a good job for Tony Bettenhausen's Alumax car here this weekend.
Teo Fabi lost one position on his pit stop, and so he now sits in ninth. That's Teo just ahead of Stefan, and it looks like Stefan is able to reel him in the first couple of corners and then loses him here in the final sweeper. While we watch Johansson, let's go to Gary Gerald.
Paul, this has been a hectic 24 hours for this team, because not only did they have to change an engine after qualifying last night to get race ready, in the warm-up this morning they also encountered problems, and so they had to then make another engine change. So two engine changes in the last 24 hours for Stefan as he continues the battle here at Portland.
Delco Electronics telemetry on Johansson's car as well. Boy, fascinating stuff.
And his nickname is Little Leaf. Therefore, you see the little leaves on the side of his helmet, right under his name, Little Leaf.
That's
the name he's had through Formula 1, Formula 3 in Europe for as long as I've known Stefan.
But not after he got to the United States.
No, never quite followed him over here. Maybe if we say Little Leaf enough, we'll actually catch on here.
We tend to Americanize him, though. Ted, Bobby, Stevie Johnson. We'll go through those at one time or another. Mauricio Gugelmann is out of the fight, and now he's with Jan.
Mauricio, you dropped out just before the first round of pit stops. What put you out?
Basically, we start with some gear box selection problems after lap 10. And I start to find the wrong gears on the gearbox until to a point that I didn't find any more gears. So I had to give it a day.
Thank you, Mauricio.
Thank you.
Paul?
Well, Johansson is right back on the tail of Teo Fabi. Good battle here for nine.
Gugelmann, with the second of the Chip Ganassi cars, now enjoys the use of a spare car from here on in. He didn't have that. And also the Hollywood sponsorship has now been increased to actually allow Gugelmann to now take on a test program.
So both of the Ganassi cars out of the running, Michael Andretti earlier, though they are two totally separate teams. Both owned by the same owner, but operated, in fact, out of entirely different facilities in Indianapolis, Indiana.
Great fight here with Johansson and Teo Fabi. Fabi so experienced in Formula One, Indy cars, sports cars, everything you could race, Fabi's been in it. Believe it or not, he's actually been successful. He's won races in just about every class of racing he's competed in.
Some slower cars just ahead as Johansson continues his pursuit of Teo Fabi. Alonzer Jr. is pulling away in front once again. We're back in Portland as Alonzer Jr. sets a record pace at 109.8 miles an hour and pulls away from Emerson Fittipaldi as we watch Stefan Johansson, who darts and looks to the inside, trying to take advantage of slower traffic in his ongoing battle for ninth place with Teo Fabi. In the meantime, Jimmy Vassar, who was involved in that confrontation earlier with Michael Andretti, is now with Gary.
He made a long, long walk back on one side of the racetrack over the bridge, and here you are with all of this disappointment. Now, from your seat, how did that business unfold with Michael?
Well, you know, I didn't see anything, really. I just turned into the corner, and I got hit in the back, and, you know, that's racing. It's just unfortunate that it had to happen so early in the race, something like that, take two cars out very early in the race. Feel bad for my sponsors, Conseco and STP, and Charlo Enns and Vital Care. You know, they're here and we're out real early, and I didn't see Michael at all alongside of me, and then I got hit in the back, and it's just unfortunate, you know, to be out so early.
Car jumped up in the air. You took kind of a buck and bronco type of a ride there.
Yeah, I got up pretty high, you know, got hit in the back tire, and that'll spit you up high, and just disappointed, you know, gonna come out of here with no points and out of the race, so.
Well, it's been a great season thus far, up in the top 10 in points, and you put this disappointment aside, and we're glad you're okay at any rate.
Thanks, Gary. Thanks.
All right, Jimmy. Paul?
A fairly consistent season for Jimmy Vassar thus far.
And you can just hear the tone of his voice and the disappointment, but Jimmy Vassar's day will come. This is a very, very good, small, well-managed team run by David Cripps, and I just think their day in the sunshine is on the way.
Brian Herta, the black 14 car, currently runs back in seventh place, while Alonzer Jr. has maintained a position right at 9.5, 10 seconds in front of the field.
Great run for Brian Herta. One thing that I think he also displays, apart from his ability to test and feel a car, he doesn't make many mistakes. Whoa, look at him get sideways there. But he doesn't seem to have a reputation for damaging racing cars or throwing them out the walls of the fences. That is something that will stand to Brian Herta. Look at the blue smoke here from Frank Freon. Frank Freon, another Indy Lights graduate. In fact, all three of these guys are graduates from the Firestone Indy Lights Championship. Frank Freon, Robbie Groff, and of course, Brian Herta, the champion last year.
So they all know one another very well. Look at Johansson. He finally is able to dart inside Teo Fabi and overhaul. Fabi takes over eighth place.
Sometimes you have to just work and work and stalk, and then you get the job done. A furious battle between Fabi and Stefan Johansson finally resolved in the favor of the Alumax car. Good run by Johansson.
Actually takes over ninth. I'm not so sure this fight is over yet.
Oh, it may not be.
Tail looks like he may want to keep this one going.
Johansson now will want to put some daylight between himself and Teo Fabi, and it looks like within half a lap, in fact, he has pulled out, what, a good six or seven car lengths.
Now with that pass by Johansson, Jan Vikas, you have an update?
Yes, we just checked with team owner Tony Bettenhausen, and he said during that last pit stop, we took some front wing out of the car because the car was getting loose. That is now what's giving Stefan the speed that he needs to pull away from Fabi.
Of course, all the Indy cars are timed by the EDS scoring system, now showing Allinger Jr. 9.2 seconds ahead of Emerson Fittipaldi. Paul Tracy runs in third place. And the system gives the teams here some remarkable information to help them calculate their position throughout the race itself. Let's look at the in-car camera for Stefan Johansson as he pursued Fabi.
Oh, look, a great run down this front straight here. Slices out from under the rear wing of Teo Fabi. And Fabi, to be quite honest, had no option, but you just can see the corner. Johansson was on his way.
Fabi Rahal unscheduled into the pits, Gary Gerald.
Yeah, they weren't expecting this one. They believe that a tire has gone down. Oh, it's not only gone down. Look at over on the left rear. It's been entirely shredded. I guess it did go down. So it's fresh rubber here for Fabi Rahal. He'll get back out here, but of course he's lost a considerable amount of time, and he's now out of the regular pit sequence. This will be a three-stop race for Rahal.
Yeah, Rahal was running 19th as he headed on into this stop to change that left rear. At the top of the order, nothing at all has changed except for that battle between Fabi and Johansson, resolved in Johansson's favor. Allinger Jr. is still the leader. And back at the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200, it is still this car, 31, Al Unser Jr. at a record pace of 110 miles an hour. The previous record, 105.2, has a 7.5-second lead over Emerson Fittipaldi. But that lead seems to be slowly dwindling. The question is Fittipaldi picking up the pace, or is Al Unser Jr. just comfortable to sit 10 seconds out in front and watch very carefully his fuel economy?
I don't know, but if Al Jr. maintains the pace, he also gets the Marlboro Pole Bonus Award, which is a carryover if a driver gets the pole and wins the race. This weekend, if Al Jr. wins, having sat on the pole, he gets $160,000 bonus.
You get an idea of the interval back to second place now. And there is Rahal, who runs well back in the field after changing that. In fact, he's not in the top 20 at all. And look how desperately he's driving to try and catch up.
And this is the second generation Honda engine with the 180-degree crankshaft, more normal a racing engine, let's say. Remember, Honda is in a learning curve. They are here for the long term. HBD, which is our factory in California, has been set up to build lots of engines for lots of customers. You only have to think back to Formula 3, Formula 3000, or Formula 1 to realize Honda is successful in every single series that they choose to officially participate in. The years to come is what Rahal is looking forward to have lots of lively Honda horses behind him.
What do you think the impact was of the situation at Indianapolis for Honda? Did that change their plan much? Are they still pretty much on the plan they were following?
I think they're probably on the plan, but what it does do, it emphasizes how difficult it is, and very often it actually spurs them on to make more development, faster development, because of missing the biggest race in the world. So in fact, it may have been a bit of a blessing in disguise if you want to look at it like that.
Nothing has changed in the top of the order. The whole top 20, in fact, remain the same. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Well, Paul, you talk about unique souvenirs. We found one here in the back of Nigel Mansell's pit. Look at this piece of craftsmanship done in sterling silver and
and gold. It's gold leaf over silver, and it is magnificent. A race driver by name of Rick Eppinger, who drives in the American Racing League Series, has created this. Actually, his jewelry designing business, Robert Rege, has come up with it. You can even take the back cover off and see down inside the power plant. 300 hours of work and a price tag of a mere, well, about $20,000. I think this is the ultimate racing souvenir, Paul.
Gary, buy me one of those.
Sure, pal.
Put the money out right there.
No problem.
My Jack car, 11th place, Alessandro Zampedri. Had a rough start in the Indy cars, but he's having a fine run today.
And I'll tell you what, it was a tremendous run, particularly in the Friday qualifying. He was the ninth fastest car after qualifying on Friday. Made the move from Euro Motorsport to run with Dale Coyne in this My Jack car. So Zampedri, who will, I believe, do the rest of the road races with Dale Coyne, having a very good showing for this, what we would probably term as one of the lesser finance teams run by Dale Coyne.
Started 21st, now runs 11th. Great run. And Fittipaldi, of course, came in to join Zampedri. He sits just in front of him. And Lazier just ahead of Fittipaldi. Is Fittipaldi still driving to catch up Al Unser Jr., who is still right at 9 seconds ahead?
Are all these Penske chassis the same? Very definitely. They don't have their favorites. This car, in fact, is chassis number 5, which is the one that Paul Tracy used and crashed at Phoenix. Remember that spectacular crash at Phoenix with Matt Schuster and Jacques Villeneuve? The car went back to England, repaired, and now Emerson uses it to run right up the front.
I'm so sure Buddy Lazier is comfortable with Fittipaldi just behind him. He's waved at him to come on by several times. Fittipaldi's just taking his time.
Well, Buddy Lazier doesn't seem to be too short on power down that front straight. Oh! See him? I don't think he saw Zampedri. He had no idea he was there, and we just got away with a possible repeat of the Andretti Jimmy Vassar incident. Oh, we've seen it so many times. You let one car through and you're totally unsighted for the one behind him that's going to try and follow him. But we got away with one.
We look through the entire order. You can see that Lazier, who was running with Zampedri there, is not really in contest for position because he runs in 20th place while Zampedri runs in 11th. And Fittipaldi still stays in pursuit of little Al from second place. 9.8 seconds ahead of Fittipaldi is his teammate Al Unser Jr. Is he cruising on to another win? 53 laps are complete. ESPN's coverage of the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200 is brought to you by PPG, world leaders in automotive finishes. By Toyota and their full line of quality cars and trucks. Toyota, I love what you do for me. And by your local Yamaha dealer, who invites you to see their exciting line of motorcycles, ATVs, and snowmobiles. At the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200, 55 laps are complete. Al Unser Jr. is the leader at a record pace of 110.1 miles an hour. Mario Andretti runs in 12th place as he continues his last lap of the Indy cars. And everywhere he goes, the fans just swamp Mario as he's on his Arrivederci tour. He made a ceremonial lap here at the track this morning just before the start of the event, and they cheered him all the way around. One of the great champions leaving, everybody thinks, to become an owner, and if so, does the car he owned end up being driven by Michael Andretti? Ryan Herta in the pits. This on the 55th lap. What are they looking for? Jan Beekes?
The reason that Brian Herta is in is A.J. Foyt told us they did not get a full load of fuel last time. They were shorted by 10 laps. That is now put him out of sequence. It's a three-stop race now for Brian Herta.
It'll be very costly for Brian Herta.
Very, very costly. Herta did such a good job, ran in the top 10 very comfortably. A very, very costly mistake by the team.
Could have been a costly problem for Mario Andretti.
Whoa. Three wide there. Herta was all the way over to the right-hand side, and Tracy just blasted through the middle.
Laherta was still coming up to speed as Mario closed and Tracy closed behind Mario. Then Mario got trapped behind the slower car of Herta. Here it is again in the Blockbuster Video blimp.
So Herta didn't change tires. Mario goes in, doesn't have the line. Tracy lines it all up. Now watch this here. Tracy's committed. Mario is nowhere to go. Three abreast. Thank you, boys, for giving everybody just enough room.
Old Tracy, there's the door. I'm going for the inside, and I'm through it.
I think Mario will be delighted to leave here and go back to Nazareth because this has not been a good weekend for him. He was not on the pace in practice or qualifying and struggling here, really, to even get himself into the top 10. So this weekend has not been a good one for Mario or Scott Goodyear, for that matter, right behind Brian Herta. This is for position.
Oh, and the same thing happens. And boy, look at Mansell.
Well, 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 we see it again. Another replay of the Andretti and Canseco Jimmy Vassar crash.
They were fighting for 12th place, Herta and Goodyear, in traffic. Now watch here. Mansell closes from behind. Goodyear goes to the inside. Herta dials across that sweeping entry.
And it didn't look as if Scott Goodyear had taken the line all the way down the inside of Brian Herta, and that's the result, an identical crash, and Scott Goodyear, who is struggling for performance this season, and now it ends up with a broken car. Here it is again.
With nearly identical damage to that suffered by Michael.
And Mansell gets a grandstand view here. He knows it's going to happen. Watch the car off the ground, exactly the same as Jimmy Vassar, such a difficult move to pull off sometimes.
Mansell almost got caught out there. I think he was expecting Herta to stay up on the inside, move to the outside just as Herta did.
Now how costly was the Brian Herta second stop, the out-of-sequence stop? It effectively puts him out of the race.
And Scott Goodyear's third DNF of the year. Look at the view from Mansell. Now watch this as Herta comes back across and then he finally sees it.
Oh, Mansell locks up that right front in an attempt to stop making contact himself. But Scott Goodyear has to walk away again and actually creates a full course yellow in the meantime.
The twin checkered flags come out. Gordon Johncock will fire up the PPG pace car. And this time they decide they do need the protection of that full course yellow to get the cars aligned behind the pace car so that they can tow Scott Goodyear's car out of the way. He's already walked away from it. And we'll watch this from the edge of the track.
They can't tow that car because that right front, left front suspension is completely broken. Vassar's car, they could simply drag it away with the tow truck. Hence, he didn't need a full course yellow for that one.
So the twin yellows are out at the start-finish line, and the pace car is on the course, and Nigel Mansell and others decide lap 59 may be a place to pit. Gary?
Well, we're watching both Mario Andretti and Nigel Mansell, the Newman Haas team drivers, coming in. Oh, what was that lap count at this point?
59 laps complete.
Well, that means it becomes a three-stop race unless this is an awfully long yellow, because 34 laps is the maximum they figure anybody can do out of 102. And Mansell's away, and it wasn't a particularly fast stop. Of course, it was under yellow. Let's go to Jan.
Jacques Villeneuve just had trouble getting into his pit because he had to go around the outside of Adrian Fernandez. Now they're cleaning his visor, but he was able to keep the engine running, even though it was a very tight turn. We've seen no changes. Oh, Adrian Fernandez was close there, and he's away.
Adrian Fernandez really hammered the throttle coming out there. Even though they're under yellow, he wants to get back in the lineup as quickly as he can. Driving for the Gallus team, by the way, H.L. Gallus, for the first time in 10 years, not here. Rick's dad watching the race. Doctor said, stay home for just one, will you please? We're back at Portland International, the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200, as we watch Brian Herta, who is involved in that confrontation with Scott Goodyear, on the tow rope now behind the IndyCar safety vehicle on his way back to the pits. And no true indication as to why. I'm surprised if it's engine, they ought to be able to just restart it. Must be something more critical. There doesn't seem to be any severe damage there unless he just wants to make sure that that car is okay before he races or runs it at all again.
It looks like there may be some drivetrain or maybe transmission damage, because you're right, the engine would just fire up. He can drive it back. But maybe the impact on that right rear suspension with Scott Goodyear, in fact, broke something terminally in that drivetrain. But a great run by Brian Herta today.
So a full course yellow underway, and we'd like to thank the Blockbuster Video blimp for providing ESPN with these beautiful aerial shots of Portland International for today's race, which is now 61 laps old of the 102-lap scheduled distance. Maybe we can find out more of the Herta situation from his car owner, A.J. Foyt, Gary.
Yeah, indeed, Paul. A.J. is here, and I know you're frustrated because of the problem that he didn't get a full load of fuel on that first stop, and it ends up being doubly costly now.
Well, that's exactly right. When you screw up like we did in the pits, then you get yourself in a position to get run over like we did, and then we come in the pits, and you're supposed to out, but it was just confusing right here in the pits, and we just need to work on it. We've had some good stops, and the boys are all young. They've done a hell of a job, but when you make one screw up, another one follows, and that's exactly what happened to us today.
Do you worry about that impacting a young rookie driver who's only in his fourth race?
I'm quite sure that did something, but if we wouldn't have screwed up the first time, we wouldn't have been in that position. So we have nobody to blame but ourselves.
Well, the car is back in right behind you now, AJ, and the crew's taking a look. Will he have a chance to get out, do you think?
I don't know. We have to look at the gearbox.
Okay. Paul?
So AJ Foyt goes over to talk to Brian Herta. As we take a look at that same situation again from Nigel's view.
And AJ confirms what we thought. A double whammy here because he should never have been in this position. He was way ahead of these cars, safely in a top seven position, I believe. And then this happens and the day is over. But fair play to AJ Foyt to take the full blame on behalf of the team and not lay the blame on Brian Herta's doorstep.
You know, there's some great drivers, contemporaries of A.J. Foyt in his early days in the 60s, Len Sutton and Jack Turner, who both live in the area here and were at the track yesterday. So fun to watch the two of them just hang around and watch racing. Len, who finished second in the Indy 500 once, and Jack, of course, you remember, did those spectacular barrel rolls down the straightaway more than once. We said, where are you going to be for the race? They said, home, watching ESPN, best view there is.
Isn't it great to see A.J. Foyt, though, emotionally involved with his team and his driver? I think he really enjoys taking somebody who nobody has heard of in IndyCar racing and trying to mold him into a true successful talent of the future.
All right, as we're ready to come back to green, Al Unser Jr. will lead the field back. Emerson Fittipaldi in second. Paul Tracy in third. In fourth is Robbie Gordon, and Nigel Mansell is fifth. Now, there are some other cars mixed in there. Robbie Groff for one. Brian Herta just rolled out of the pits and back into the fight. Now second place Fittipaldi has to handle up Fernandez and Groff, and does so.
And that's a battle for position between Groff and Fernandez, 13th and 14th position. Mike Groff in the Honda and Adrian Fernandez in the Gallus car.
So while they gave way to Fittipaldi, they had to do it very carefully so they could continue their fight. But Al Unser Jr. squirted out into the lead, and Fittipaldi is already playing catch-up.
Lots and lots of battles going on here. That's Dominic Dobson's car. You see behind them the PacWest car, Groff, Fernandez, and Dominic Dobson, 13, 14, and 15. Now, of course, has the latest development Honda engine. He didn't have it in Detroit. He does have it here. Ran well in practice, looking for more horsepower though from this engine. But right now, learning and gaining valuable reliability mileage.
Now, you think the season has been rough for Rahal. Imagine it for Groff, because he's always had one step down as Fernandez moves to the inside, grabs the position from Groff.
That's how to make it clean.
To the inside as well, looking for racing room.
That's right. That's how to make it clean, Paul. You have to get alongside the other car to make sure they do not have an opportunity to pull in. That's what Fernandez did there with Mike Groff.
At the front, it's still Little Al. Six cars on the leader lap. Even with that caution, we are still running at a record pace, 106.3 miles an hour. The record's 105.
Paul Tracy behind Villeneuve. That is not a battle for a position. Villeneuve is seventh. Tracy is third. But you can see he's almost a full lap ahead of Jacques Villeneuve.
Next car behind Tracy will be Robbie Gordon's Valvoline car. There it comes off the corner. Gary Gerald's now with Scott Goodyear, can maybe update us more on the Herta situation. Whoa. We'll hang on just a second, Gary, as they're tight once again in the festival corners. And Tracy finally clears Villeneuve. And now he can really set sail. So, Gary, Scott Goodyear's perception of that confrontation.
The chicane, the festival corner, has been the hot spot all day long, and you and Brian Herta end up getting into it, and what has been a great frustrating season for you continues now. Tell us what happened from your seat.
Well, we had a good weekend going along. We didn't qualify all that well yesterday afternoon. We lost some ground with a car, but we got it back this morning, but tough track to pass on. It's almost a little bit like Detroit, and you have to take every advantage that you can get, and I was trying to run down with Mario, because every time we get the traffic, I wanted to be able to get him, and I just didn't want to have to be hung behind Herta there, because he just came out of the pits, and we didn't have enough room, and we lost out.
Thank you, Scott. I'm sorry.
Thanks.
All right, Paul.
So continuing to center up on Mike Groff, Dominic Dobson sets up just behind him. That is a continuing battle for position. It's a battle for 14. And Dobson wants it. Not Dobson. Sharp.
Scott Sharp. Scott Sharp, Trans Am champion of the past, comes down inside Mike Groff. I would say Mike Groff is struggling a little bit here from horsepower. And look at Robbie Gordon. Round the outside. If the track isn't wide enough, just stick the outside wheels on the grass and the dirt.
Al Unser Jr., not pulling away like he did before. He runs 1.8 seconds ahead of Fittipaldi, then Tracy, and then Robbie Gordon, this car right here, with his scheduled pit stops beginning again within the next two laps. They're on lap 66. 102 laps, the scheduled distance here, and Al Unser Jr. continues to run at a record pace as he dominates the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200. Back at the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200, 68 laps complete. Al Unser Jr. in car 31 is the leader by 2 seconds ahead of his teammate Emerson Fittipaldi. And the indications are that the Penske team is ready for little Al to make a stop. As he pulls on the pit road, Jan Beekes waits. 80 mile an hour pit road speed, Jan.
That's right, we can see him holding it right to 80 miles an hour. He has a nice clean shot, and yes, it's right on the marks. We'll take a look for changes here. Remember, he won his first ever IndyCar race here 10 years ago. What an anniversary it would be if he could win here again. I'm standing above the fuel tower. They're watching for every bit of fuel. The tires are off, he's holding the revs up. 14.9, he's underway. Very much the way that Penske always does it. Everything just going according to plan.
So Al Unser Jr. has completed his stop. During that stop, boy, the brakes were really smoking on the front. Of course, they get the most work.
Really, really beginning to smoke. You got to keep these wheels rotating, or else the pads and the cast iron discs just get too hot stationary in that one position. But this battle is on now, because Al Unser Jr. has made a good stop. But remember, your out lap is just as important as your in lap. And Emerson rolls down pit lane.
So Emerson Fittipaldi, one lap later, makes his stop as the leader of the race. He picked up the lead when little Al went in. Gary Gerald waits.
We look along with the crew, Paul, and here he is, perfectly on target. The veteran driver, a former world champion in Formula One, a former IndyCar champion, the defending champion here in Portland. A lot of brake dust coming off the wheels that came off. You heard about the brake smoke from little Al's car, making sure they have to get every bit of fuel. He's rolling in 15.2 seconds.
The join. Oh, look how close it's going to be.
He gets it. For the ball, look at Junior.
Cold tires for Fittipaldi. Cold tires are going to be less in terms of their grip. And Al Unser Jr. is able to get them, but they're right together now. We've got a battle. How is Fittipaldi's tires come up to temperature? We've got a fight.
And how important was your outlap? If Al Jr. lost half a second on that outlap, he would not now be in the lead of this race. How close can this be?
Update on Emo, Gary.
Well, Paul, we were just sharing the emotion with the crew, because as they went down toward the chicane and as they merged, as you were calling it, the crew could see that it was going to be very, very close. And Emerson's crew just erupted on this side of the wall, because they know they've got a battle going right now with their teammate.
Emerson very much still in the fight. And by the way, to the joy not only of the team, as Robbie Gordon makes his stop in third place, But, you know, there's quite a club that is built up of people who listen to the two-way conversations between the pits and the cars on scanner radios. This year, Roger Penske started scrambling those voice transmissions. They got so much mail that they have decided to unscramble. So if you sent in the first letter, send in a nice one and thank Roger for doing that. Let's take a look as they were coming out of the pits. And Paul Tracy and Al Unser Jr. battling together, Fittipaldi and Unser Jr. Here they come.
And this is great stuff. Al Jr.'s on warm tires. Emerson has the line. Now he thinks he's safe. Al Jr. sets him up. Side by side blast through and just about manages to scrape by with the lead.
Same view this time from Johansson, who was just behind him. Boy, he really fought through the corner. Thought he could move to the outside, then tucked her back to the inside.
Great, great inter-team rivalry here between the Penske team.
Gary Gerald.
Well, the third member of this trio is in for his final service. There were no changes on Emerson's car, and we have not detected any changes made at the front. Don't see anything happening at the back other than routine. This was just over 16 seconds.
How good are these cars, Gary? You see no changes on Tracy's. There were no changes on Emerson's or Al Jr.'s. These cars are very, very well set up.
So Paul Tracy picked up the lead just for a lap as Fittipaldi and Al Unser Jr. battled. Then Tracy had to relinquish the lead as he came in. It's been a Penske day the entire way. No car in the lead other than a Penske machine. Robbie Gordon dropped down a bit on his stop and came out in sixth place. In fifth place right now is Raul Boisel, who's having a good day, started 12th, now runs in sixth and continues on the leader lap.
End of the lap here, second gear corner, 37.5 on the steering wheel. We know what that is. That's what his digital readout tells him. He has used 37.5 gallons of fuel. He has no option but to peel off into the pit lane.
You're going no further after that.
Looks like Robbie Groff ahead of him in the Condor. Penske, the second entry of Tony Bettenhausen's. Robbie Groff has only had a couple of races this year. Graduate from the Indy Lights division. Look at Bozell. Whoa! Locks up the rear, misses a gear, goes into neutral for about a half a second, and loses about six or seven car lengths to Robbie Groff.
Delco Electronics telemetry gives you great representation, real time, of what's happening in that car.
The ahead of him, Groff sticks the wheel off the racetrack onto the dirt, kicks him up. Screams, 13,200 revs, Bozell's Ford engine down the long back straight.
And he searches ahead, probably about a full straightaway plus some, for Nigel Mansell, who runs in third. Al Unser Jr. is still the king in Portland. And here at Portland, the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200. Al Unser Jr. is the leader of the race. Fittipaldi is a second and a half back, doing everything he can to close on his teammate. Nigel Mansell is third, then Paul Tracy, then Raul Boisel, Robbie Gordon, Villeneuve, Johansson, Fabi, and Alessandro Zampedri runs in 10th. Lap leaders today. See any car there or team other than Penske? I don't think so. Boy, they are just so incredibly powerful in this series.
And yet Al Jr. cannot relax here for a second. There are no team orders. It's every man for himself. And this is a championship battle going on here that we're watching, not just a race battle. Remember, Al Jr. safely in the lead, well, we thought safely, at Detroit before being punted off, not purposely, by Paul Tracy. Now he's secure again, but there's a long, long way to go yet.
Willie T. Ribbs, who had trouble early and then got restarted, got tangled up on the start of the race itself as we look at the running order after 75 laps. Interesting announcement out of the United States Auto Club this week as they reduced, not for these engines, but for the Mercedes purpose-built pushrod engine, reduced the boost pressures for next year. What kind of impact do you think it's going to have, Derek?
I think if Penske has another year's development on that engine and the engine car package, he will be just as fast as he was this year, if not faster. So if that rule says it as it is, everybody that wants to go to Indianapolis with a realistic chance of winning may have to go with one of those new modified stock block rule engines, the 209, just like the Mercedes-Benz that Penske has.
But my question would be, based on its performance this year, even with that reduction, don't you almost have to look at a purpose-built push rod for Indy for next year? And if so, where's it going to come from?
Well, that's right. And of course, Mercedes probably want to sell or supply their engines to other people. Remember, we had the Greenfield engine that was undeveloped this year. And we also have the Brayton-built engine that's now owned by John Menard. But I think it's unfortunate that people will have to have possibly two separate engine programs to go next year and be competitive in every race.
And also Ford Cosworth has at least an engine in drawing, if not one in existence, that also can fulfill that purpose. Other racing news coming out lately. IndyCar announcing all of the promoters that are on board for the long term in the series. Big announcement. And as a result of that, they're able to now, very early in the year, put their schedule for the future together. And that's good for everybody. That allows the teams to plan.
That is good
for fans to plan.
Exactly. The number one thing you want is consistency and long-term planning, because remember, we're talking $7 to $10 million per car to run front-running cars here in the IndyCar Championship. So the longer you can project your series and your stability in your championship, the more commitments you can get from commercial entities. And of course, when you have the commitment, you have the stability.
Unser Jr. still just a second and a half ahead of Fittipaldi. Mansell third.
You would think watching the Penske freight train here that they test here all the time. I was surprised when Chuck Sprague, the team manager, told me they have not tested here for 6 years. 6 years they have not tested here. Reason being, he said Nigel Bennett's cars always seem to go very well here at Portland, and they don't see the necessity to come here and test. I said, with three top drivers, how do you pick who goes and does your test? He said, hey, I simply go, I ask each one of them, do you want to test? If they all say no, I make one of them test. If they all say yes, then I try and just divide it up as possible. So it's not as regimented as you would imagine between these three top line drivers.
32's cars started here today. 26 are still running with 79 laps complete, and seven are still on the leader lap. The battle is at the front of the field. As the Penske cars fight it out, Fittipaldi trying to close on Al Unser Jr. Nigel Mansell still staying powerful in third place and hoping that these two get in a rough battle, maybe a little too rough, and he can assume the lead. Let's go back in the field. The last car on the lead lap is Jacques Villeneuve. He runs in seventh place. Robbie Gordon is ahead on the race course.
And his team owner, team manager Barry Green, is still amazed at how quickly this young man learns new racetracks. He's never been here before, yet he comes here and he's on the pace immediately. Very good with the car. Tony Sicale seems to understand him, give him what he needs. So Barry Green's new team, the Forsyth Green team, backed by players, probably the best new team addition to the IndyCar ranks for a long, long time.
You know what I like about them is how much fun they all seem to have with their racing. All through the team, Barry Green, the Forsyths, all of the sponsors on the team, including Richard Klein, Klein too. I mean, they've just been having a great time and seem to enjoy it. He's finished second, ninth, seventh in the last three races. Remarkable driver. Very definitely one to watch.
You only have to look back at his performance at the Indianapolis 500. Willie T is in trouble. Willie T is in trouble and almost got tagged around the outside. Yellow flags fly. Has he stalled it? Yes, he has.
Yep, he's not going anywhere. They're going to have to get the corner workers to get out there on a very crowded race course with still 26 cars running. Al Unser Jr. picks up a little on Fittipaldi, 1.7 seconds. He just lost it going into the corner.
Locks up the rear brakes, a complete 360, and it was Stefan Johansson who crawled around the outside. But Willie T doesn't keep that engine running. The tow truck may have to be dispatched.
Yeah, they're going to go out the IndyCar safety team and see if they can push her off quickly. I think I'd go out there with all these guys coming down.
Quickly, boys, quickly. You got battles raging here. Oh, look at how close this is again. Whoa, now it's down to 1.6 seconds. So Al Jr., as he wades his way through the traffic here, has a real battle on his hands with Emerson.
1.6 measured at the start-finish. It's a little closer than that now. As Fittipaldi close in, Al Unser Jr. has some traffic ahead, and the battle for the lead continues. Back at the Budweiser, G.I. Joe's 200 on board with Raul Boysel, who seems to be struggling a bit here.
He's in trouble. He's in trouble with the gearbox. Just listen. He's got no gears. He's got the one he's in, and that's it. Just listen here. We're going to follow him onto the back straight. That is third gear. Watch what happens here. Look at this. He's stuck in gear. He's stuck in gear. Third gear is all he has. He's in deep trouble. See, he just keeps it at 12,000 RPM at 100 miles an hour. He's obviously on the way to see Dick Simon.
Keep an eye on Raul Boysel, who is running in fifth place. He should turn off to the right here. Though I'm not sure there's a whole lot they can do about a situation like that.
No, if it was fifth gear, he probably could get away with it. But third gear, way, way too short a gear.
Let's go back a little bit earlier. Willie T. Ribbs got in trouble. The view is from Stefan Johansson's car as they complete the front stretch.
Watch how quickly this happens. Look at this. Immediately locks the rears, full 360, and Johansson has to make an instantaneous decision. Do I go around the outside?
All right, let's go on to Gary Gerald now.
We heard from A.J. Foyt earlier and how the crew was taking the responsibility for the problems for Brian Herta. Brian, I know it's disappointing in only your fourth IndyCar race. This is the first real taste of adversity, however, you've had after three great previous runs.
Well, it really is. Our first three races, we didn't get any big breaks going our way, but then again, we didn't have anything going against us either. So, you know, we had pretty good races and we're able to finish. And this is the first time anything really has happened to us. And, yeah, in the end, of course, we had the electrical problem with the motor, so it really washed itself out anyways. But I just want to thank Copenhagen and the team for giving me a really good car today to run.
After the contact with Goodyear, when you came into the pits, did you think you were going to be able to get restarted and get back out to compete?
Well, I wasn't really sure. I know he hit me awfully hard, and I was really surprised because I didn't expect him to be coming in like that. But, the car seemed to hold together, and yeah, that's just really a tribute to all the guys for putting in such a strong car for me.
Thanks, Brian. Paul?
Fittipaldi climbing all over the back of Al Unser Jr. as they use slower traffic to Fittipaldi's advantage. Al Unser Jr. certainly knows he is there, but he also knows that he has to handle up slower traffic just ahead. That was Herro on the front stretch that gave Fittipaldi an opportunity to really close in on little Al.
And as long as he has clear road, he seems to be able to control the situation. Traffic is a complete unknown every time you arrive up behind it. He poked his nose under Matt Schuster, and he had to back right out of it. That's what gave Emerson the run. Al Jr. is in a real fight.
Fittipaldi much faster by 2 miles an hour on the last lap, owing in part to the traffic that little Al found himself in the middle of. Now they are still in more traffic. Fittipaldi's awfully good at it, but so is little Al. We've got a potentially great fight here.
And Emerson knows Al Jr. is one of the hardest men to actually make a clean pass on. Al Jr. knows exactly how and where to position that car to drive defensively. But Emerson has an advantage as Jr. picks his way through the traffic.
Little Al can make that car mighty wide. There's the traffic just ahead of Little Al. And that could mean plenty of trouble for Little Al. We're now down at lap 87 of a 102-lap race. So Little Al can't tarry here.
Oh, you have to be careful here. That's Parker Johnstone in the Acura car. We know that's not that quick down the straight. Villeneuve will try and pass him, and Al Jr. will be all over the two of them.
And Villeneuve could actually be the bigger problem for them, couldn't he? Because he runs up there with the front all the time. He's going to be hard for little Al to get around.
Yeah, and that's Fernandez ahead of him. So this is a freight train here. Al Jr. needs to be really careful. There's Emerson all over his rear wing.
Fernandez Perez comes to the inside of Greco. Johnstone waves Villeneuve by, and Fittipaldi looks for room. Whoa, that's what you got to watch out for.
Oh. How many times have we seen it? Parker Johnstone moves over, takes the line. He's got to get out of the way of the leaders. You need to move over. You need to look in your mirrors.
Of course, Jack is now fighting to try and stay on the lead lap. He currently runs in sixth. Last car on the leader lap.
Double apex corners. It's actually Marco Greco, I believe.
Update, Jan Beekes.
Well, you were talking about how important it is for Jacques Villeneuve to stay ahead. In fact, he's had that radio conversation. They said, whatever you do, stay ahead of Little Al, because like you said, that makes a big lap difference here.
That makes it doubly hard for Al Unser Jr.
Now look at this. Here's a surprise. Al Jr. was not able to outdrag the Honda in Parker Johnstone's Acura car on the way down that back straight. Emerson is still there, ready to pounce. Oh, look at this.
Fittipaldi looks to the inside, as does Al Unser Jr. Jr.'s going to go for getting two of them if he can. He can't.
Doesn't get by Marco Greco. Emerson comes through.
They both come by Parker Johnstone. Now Marco Greco is the target ahead. But Fittipaldi is looking for opportunity.
Whoa, look at Al Jr. It took him a full lap to get by Parker Johnstone. Now let's see, does Marco Greco see Emerson?
Well, Little Al had greater confidence in Greco, who is a regular on the series, as opposed to the rookie at this race, Johnstone. Now Fittipaldi will handle up the fellow Brazilian, Marco Greco.
And suddenly Al Jr. gets some breathing room. Look at this. Six or seven car lengths in the space of two or three corners. Al Jr. can take a half a breath because he has a little bit of room now.
Yeah, but there's still traffic ahead that's going to matter. There you see it. And just that quickly, he's on top of it. Gary Gerald.
Raul Boisel, we thought it was stuck in gear. They broke the shifting mechanism down in the cockpit. The crew has hurriedly made a repair. He had the helmet off, thought his day was done. Helmet's back on, gloves coming on. He's going back in the cockpit for the final laps, Paul.
Oh, so you can repair the thing. Shift mechanism in the cockpit.
Well, there's no points for finishing at the end, only points for the top 12. Boisel is well out of that at the moment. But Al Jr. continues to rock and roll here.
Little Al out in front, but Fittipaldi closing quickly in traffic, very much a concern for both Fittipaldi and Unser Jr. Well, they've maintained this interval for the past lap and a half. Al Unser Jr. and Emerson Fittipaldi now closing on Villeneuve. And he could very clearly be the factor that decides this race, because he is not going to be easy to pass. At the same time, Al Unser Jr. has a reputation for making a race car very wide indeed. As we move to the closing laps now, 92 laps complete here at Portland in what is a record pace at 105 miles an hour, 105.2 for the record. We're now running at 107.38. And the Penske cars have led every lap here, either Tracy or Fittipaldi or the current leader and the pole sitter, Al Unser Jr.
And FYI, the fastest man all day here has been Al Unser Jr. 61.1 was his fastest lap. Emerson's fastest lap was a 61.2. However, that was earlier. Emerson is now running 0.2 seconds quicker on the last lap again than Al Unser Jr. And Jr. still is caught in a traffic jam.
So Jr. and Fittipaldi, the only cars here to run laps at better than 114 miles an hour. Look from Ray Hall's car as Little Al comes flying past. And Al gives Fittipaldi plenty of room.
You saw what he did there, moved way down to the inside and downchanged.
Real sportsmanship out of Ray Hall as he moved over there. And boy, look how fast they disappear from Ray Hall.
Boy, what a hard chase this is for Emerson. As soon as he gets up behind Al Jr., then he gets the bad brakes in traffic and has to make up inch by inch that time and room again, all the way back up to him. But Fernandez and Jacques Villeneuve are in a battle, not for position. Fernandez peels off. Oh, Al Jr. needs to get by Jacques Villeneuve.
Fernandez heads for the pits. Fittipaldi closes in on the back of Little Al once again.
Here we go, here we go.
Now, this is critical for Fittipaldi. Little Al has passed. He hopes that Jack knows he's back there and will give him the room.
Yes, he does. Good move by Jacques Villeneuve. You don't need to be in the fight. Let the two leaders get on along their way and fight it out in a clean, good, hard battle. And what a battle it is. Boy, you hope your teammate lets you off the hook and lets you take it easy. But not here. This is the way it should be.
94 laps complete. 8 to go. Hunter Jr. leads it. Fittipaldi is second. Nigel Mansell is back about 21 seconds behind Fittipaldi in third place. Then Paul Tracy. Then Robbie Gordon rounds out the top five. Robbie Gordon had a problem on his stop that really dropped him down in the order, or he could be even more competitive than that.
It was a 37-second fuel stop, which cost him a lot of time. That was why he's now trying to make some of that time up.
Looking way back through the crowd to pick up Nigel Mansell, the third place car. There he is, Raul Boisel right behind him after having his gearbox, actually his shift lever repaired. And Nigel Mansell is heading down pit road for what should be routine and final. Jan Vikas?
Well, I tell you what, Paul, you want to have your stopwatch on this one. All they're going to do is give it a little bit of fuel. It'll be a 2-second time pit stop. That's all the fuel they need. That will bring it to a stop. Let's see. Here it goes. The fuel is in. Oh, man, it took them a couple minutes to get it engaged. Now they have it timed. They tap on the back, and Nigel now is out of here.
Well, not quite a couple minutes, but I'll bet it felt like it.
A splash and go still takes 8 long seconds. And remember, the 80 miles an hour pit lane speed limit is what also eats up valuable time.
Back beyond Beacon.
Paul, you could see that it was a 2-second timed fuel pit stop, but what happened was they had a problem with the valve going in and the valve coming out. So like you say, that turned what could have been 3 or 4 seconds into 8.
That's the valve on the nozzle going into the car, Jan.
Yes, it's the large nozzle they have to engage for the fuel to go through. Let's check in with Gary Gerrell.
Jacques Villeneuve just also made a splash and go, and he was in here for about 3 to 4 seconds. That's it. He's gone. So some of these teams unable to go the distance in 2 stops as they'd hoped.
So Al Unser Jr. with Emerson Fittipaldi doing everything he can to catch up. When we come back, we'll see who will take the Portland 200. Back now for the final 4 laps of the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200, Portland International Raceway. 102 laps of scheduled distance. The fight is for the lead of the race between Al Unser Jr. and Emerson Fittipaldi. It's broken off for the moment. Here is Robbie Gordon, who had that problem and as a result has fallen back into 5th place, looking ahead, trying to find Nigel Mansell.
Oh, and he's not that far behind Mansell. Mansell is just up the road about 3 seconds because of that splash and go fuel stop. Now, if Gordon can run without a splash and go, he may have a chance to catch Mansell. There it is right here. That is not that far of a chase for Robbie Gordon.
No, Gordon's very definitely in visual contact and is closing through the festival corners. Named for the Portland Rose Festival here. Marvelous time. There are over 20,000 square dancers in town here for national contests as well. This city is really alive, but the focus is on the IndyCars and its race. 99 laps complete for Al Unser Jr. Let's go to Gary Gerrell.
Paul, you may be wondering about this splash-and-go situation that brought Mansell and Villeneuve in late. How does that impact the Penske team? We just checked with Richard Buck, who, of course, is, along with Roger Penske, keeping close tabs on Al Unser Jr. They said, we just set our fuel situation, our fuel setting in the cockpit at 98, which means they are going flat out. They don't have to worry about coming in for fuel in these final laps. They don't have to conserve. So that's a great position, obviously, to be in.
Fittipaldi's fallen back a bit as Little Al runs on to clear race course. No traffic ahead. Past few miles, that's worked to his advantage. Whenever he gets clear, he tends to run away from Fittipaldi.
2 laps left. In fact, the traffic that you mentioned just up the road, in fact, is Mansell and Robbie Gordon. So Al Jr. continues this total Penske domination over the course of these long, long races. They maintain their momentum and just break the back and break the heart of everybody else. The main thing they have is those good, solid rear tires over long, long runs.
Yeah, but if he catches up to Robbie Gordon and Mansell, neither one of those guys are in the least bit interested in giving way to him, and they could bottle him up. They've got their own fight.
Which is exactly what Emerson is praying for right now, because Emerson, lap for lap in clear traffic, does not have any more over Al Jr. In fact, is dropping back, as you said earlier, a little bit more as the laps go on here. One more lap for Al Unser Jr. and the Penske record continues.
100 laps are complete now, 101, the white flag. One more circuit to go for Al Unser Jr. as he closes on traffic. Fittipaldi sits just behind, looking for any opportunity that he can find. Little Al has to concern himself with traffic just ahead. But that traffic should be well aware of him. In the meantime, Gordon and Mansell
great
in their
fight. Great fight with Gordon and Mansell. Gordon smells the position. He's going to give it everything he has.
Little Al heading for the backside of the course now, coming around Marco Greco. Running alone.
And you see the room he gave him, moved all the way out round the high side just in case Greco came in too deep into the apex.
Fittipaldi does not come around Greco. Al Unser Jr. in the final curves of this track that it produced at one time the closest finish ever in IndyCar history. It'll be a little wider than that as Al Unser Jr. comes onto the straightaway. And the checkered flag comes out, and they make it six in a row for Roger Penske as Al Unser Jr. from the pole takes the win. Fittipaldi comes across the line just behind him. Paul Tracy will come across in third place. We'll try to track the battle between Robbie Gordon and Mansell for you as they head for the line.
Celebrations well deserved for the captain, Roger Penske. And Al Jr. notches up another one.
There's Mansell and Gordon. They're still in the fight. Paul Tracy just came across for third place. This fight is over on the backside. Gordon's right there. Traffic for both of them.
Oh, look
Johansson
at this.
Johansson just ahead. Hero just ahead of that.
Look, watch Gordon. Watch Gordon.
Gordon's looking for any opening he can find. He'll haul to the inside.
Here we
go. Try to pass Mansell. And they scream for the line, and Gordon looks like he has him.
He gets him. He does get him, I believe.
So as they come to the line, a last lap battle resolves itself in favor of Robbie Gordon, and he takes fourth place away from Nigel Mansell in the last couple hundred yards. And he and Mansell give one another thumbs up and thank each other for a terrific fight.
Well, we have seen many times today, you don't get better than that. And we just saw another opportune moment presented to Robbie Gordon as Mansell gets caught up in traffic. Lines the Valvoline Cummins car up perfectly. And in the drag race, he grabs that position from Nigel Mansell. What a great run by Gordon.
The Penske cars did it at Milwaukee. They do it again. A Penske finish, 1, 2, and 3. Unser, Fittipaldi, and Paul Tracy. We'll talk to several of them when we come back. Al Unser Jr. takes the victory here. The three cars came down and parked in formation on the straightaway. And Gary Gerald is there with a man who is somewhat richer right now.
I'll tell you what, not only is he richer, the emotion, Shelley is here now as well. Junior, I don't know where to start. There's the Marlboro bonus of a mere $150,000 that goes on top of all of this, and that brings an ear-to-ear grin. Tell us about your day and the importance of being able to get the jump on Nigel going into those festival curves on the opening lap.
Well, I tell you, I just, you know, I want to thank the whole Marlboro Team Penske for putting this car together. You know, all my sponsors, you know, Bosch and Mobil and everybody, they just did a wonderful job. It was an exciting day. You know, I really needed to get the jump on Nigel to get into the corner, and it was great. You know, we were able to stretch out a good enough lead, and then the yellows kind of hurt me a little bit, and Emerson worried me big time. And so, you know,
here's Emerson, and the congratulations continue.
Hey, bud, thanks.
And Paul Tracy on the other side. Now, tell us about the traffic scenario there late in the race when Emerson is just a second behind.
Yeah, well, I tell you, it was really worrying me a little bit. The traffic, I was starting to take some moves that I usually wouldn't do because Emerson was right on me, and I kind of figured that was a lot of the reason why he got by Nigel, but I didn't know for sure. You know, I'm sure they got caught in traffic or so on, and that's what happened there, but... It was great, you know, and I just want to say hi to Cody and Shannon at home.
Right here,
and,
big guy.
We did good.
Indeed, Dad did. And here's Emerson Fittipaldi. Now, Emerson, I think this is, what, the fourth time this year that you've ended up running second. You're piling up the points, and I know you're happy, but you'd much rather be number one.
Well, I'm very happy. I think I know it was another great race. I was slow on the start, and the last segment of the race, I ran very strong, and I was catching Answer, and then Junior was quick in traffic through Mario, and I lost some ground, but he did a fantastic job, and Paul did a very good job. I mean, 1, 2, 3.
The second pit stop, your crew did a marvelous job, because that's the one that got you out there right on the tail. In fact, you and Junior were battling coming out there as you merged on the front straightaway, you with cold tires.
Well, I had cold tires, yes, already warm tires, but they did a fantastic job, the whole team. I mean, that's what else we need. 1, 2, 3, fantastic.
Indeed it is. Let's go to Jan.
We're standing by Robbie Gordon. That was a fantastic finish. Did you think you were out of it after that long pit stop?
Well, I didn't think we were out of it. I knew we would be good for fifth or sixth position, but I didn't think we'd be able to climb all the way back up to where Mansell was. And I tell you, that was one of the most fun times I've ever had racing. You know, that whole last lap, I'd go inside, he'd go outside, and we were just splitting traffic. And it was a good time.
How does that make you feel, though? World champion Nigel Mansell, you're out there duking it out, and you beat him at the line.
Well, you know, we've been working hard all year, and, you know, the Valvoline team's just been doing a great job. I think this moves us into third place in points, and we're happy.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
He's absolutely right. Moves into third place in the points. Let's take a look at the margin of victory there. Look at that. There is the line, the white line. That's the margin for third place, third to fourth. Fourth to fifth. Well, Robbie Gordon had a great final lap, but Balancer Jr. had the best. Let's go back to Gary.
Well, here's the third member of the winning Penske trio, and we saw them in formation in Milwaukee. Now we see them on the front straightaway together here in Portland. And, Paul, this has got to be a marvelous feeling, the role that this team is on. And I know after what happened in Detroit with the bumping incident that we talked about at the start of the show, all of that now goes totally behind you, and everybody's smiling again, and everybody's happy.
Well, it really is. It was a great finish for the Marlboro crew, and 1, 2, 3, Emerson and Al had a good race. I couldn't keep pace with the pace that they were going, and I came out the last stop behind Mansell, and I knew that he was going to have to pit if I kept pressure on him, and so I had to try to catch him. He was 12 seconds in front, so I caught him. It took me a long time, and then I was trying to chase him, so he had to come in for fuel. So it was a good race. I'm happy to be third with my crew, with the Marlboro team, and looking forward to Cleveland, looking for that $1 million.
Oh, yeah. You talk about bonuses. Junior got 150. Paul's going for $1 million at Cleveland if he wins the pole and wins the race. We wish you well. We'll see you in a couple of weeks there. They want you on the podium.
Okay, we'll see you in Cleveland.
All right. Paul?
All right, we still got plenty of time to talk to other competitors here of the day and more to do as we take a look at the Columbia River, just a few hundred yards from the course. Today's coverage of the IndyCars on ESPN has been brought to you by Havilland 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car. By American Honda, who has been making quality cars in America for the past 11 years. And by Midas, the Midas way, the way it should be. Well, we couldn't have given you some of the great coverage and the aerial shots that you saw if it weren't for the blockbuster video blimp, piloted today by Terry Dillard of Lake Monroe, Florida, especially the resolution of that battle between Robbie Gordon and Nigel Mansell at the end. Let's go trackside once again, Jan Bikas.
Well, a driver that was just behind that battle was Jacques Villeneuve. And Jacques, you said that you got bottled up in some traffic and that held you back.
Yeah, I was running the first part of the race behind Robbie Gordon, and toward the end of the, just before the pit stop, I was actually catching him a little bit, but then I got stuck behind Fernandez, and he was quite fast down the straight, and I couldn't overtake him, and most of the race I was stuck behind him and fighting to to try to get by him so I could catch up with the leaders, but there was nothing to do.
All right, thank you, Jacques. Let's check in with Gary.
Alessandro Zampedri had to start way back in this field in Dale Coyne's number 19, the MyJack car, and they just kept working their way through, and the smile tells you the success story. A seventh place finish. Congratulations. How tough was your day today?
It was very tough because we started on 21st after we had some problems on Saturday in qualifying, and we were ninth on Friday, but the car was great. The team did a great job. The guys in the pit stop, they were absolutely fantastic. We make so many positions. I drive safely. The car was okay. And that's it. I have to slow him down from the middle of the race because of the fuel.
I think he likes it, Paul.
And I'll tell you, Dale Coyne's crew, the MyJack team, really deserved that run. Alan Sir Jr.'s car, almost ignored now, but Richard Buck and Jerry Breon there on the back wing as they push the car back for its final inspection after a pretty good run for little Al.
And you would think it's a logistical nightmare to run three front-running cars, but Chuck Sprague, the team manager, told me they learned a lot in 1990, the last time they ran three cars, and it is nowhere near as bad this year as it was back then.
Adrian Fernandez finished in 10th place, and he's with Jan Bikas.
Now, Adrian, you had a battle there, not for position, but with Jacques Villeneuve. That was quite a battle, even though not for position.
Well, you know, I was trying to run as hard as we could because, you know, the car was better in this after the first pit stop, and we were getting, you know, time, and so we were trying just to get more position, so we were trying hard.
But the strategy is very important. You got out of pit position, though, as far as your strategy. You got out of the normal sequence.
Yeah, that hurt us because we had to pit a little bit just for a little bit extra fuel, and that hurt us a little bit, so just next time we get it right.
Thank you, Adrian.
Thank you.
Paul?
So Adrian Fernandez finishes in 10th, and we still have more to come here from Portland in the Budweiser G.I. Joe's 200 as Al Unser Jr. celebrates the win. Beautiful view of downtown Portland, not far away. How does it feel to drive in your very first IndyCar race? Well, Gary Gerald may have the answers.
Let's ask Parker Johnstone. How does it feel to compete now in your first IndyCar race? I think it was a thrill.
Well, it was fantastic. We had some problems, but the guys at Comtech and all the folks at Acura and Honda have supported us to this level. For us just being here was a victory, and to do the G.I. Joe's 200 in Portland, in my home state, it was fantastic.
Enjoy. Looking forward to seeing you in events coming ahead. Let's go to Jan Bikas.
Well, Stefan Johansson, you were right in the driver's seat for a lot of action today. A lot of things happening in front of you. Pretty wild, huh?
It was a pretty frantic race at times. Yeah, luckily I managed to stay out of trouble today. So, you know, at least we got a finish, although maybe not quite as high as what we would have hoped for.
Thank you, Stefan. Paul?
Well, Stefan Johansson. The race is run, and once again, a good number of cars, 25 of them still running at the finish as we look through the entire running order here. Six wins now for the Penske team. You can look at that a couple of other ways as we'll look down through the order. There's the top six for you. For Roger Penske, if you include Winston Cup, it's 9 races in a row with Rusty. And for Al Unser Jr., career win number 23, 6 in a row for Penske. The IndyCar record is 7. George Bignotti and A.J. Foyt back in 1964. So that's the next target for the Penske organization. Of course, when you're talking Bignotti and Foyt, you're talking one mechanic, one car.
Mark Smith, hometown favorite here, struggles all weekend, but manages to finish in 16th place. And then you go back to Parker Johnstone and the rest of the runners.
Only second time in the history of Portland that the race has been won from the pole. Danny Sullivan did it back in 1988. Of course, he's still looking at Winston Cup rides this year and is not driving in an IndyCar. Teo Fabi had an engine break. He was the last one to actually fall out of the race itself. So another successful day, not only for the drivers, but for the engineers and crews as they kept their cars in the fight. And Al Unser Jr. takes a leap ahead in the points. Fittipaldi had closed on him, but now with this win, once again, little Al takes a jump ahead, but Fittipaldi is still in contact. Here is the 1995 IndyCar schedule as we go to Miami, not Tamiami Park where the IndyCars raced before, but down on Biscayne Boulevard, and then off to Surfer's Paradise, and then Phoenix, Long Beach. Nazareth will move into April from its normal position in late September. Then Indianapolis on its traditional date, Milwaukee, Detroit, Portland. Well, look at the rest of the IndyCar schedule. Elkhart Lake, four races in July, Toronto, Cleveland, Brooklyn, and then Lexington, Ohio, Mid-Ohio Sports Car Course, and Loudoun, New Hampshire, Vancouver, and then we'll end the season fairly early on September 10th next year.
So the Penske freight train rolls on. It's a joy to watch, but undoubtedly it is a major headache that only gets worse for every other team who is trying to win here in IndyCar racing.
Of the question marks that were started at the beginning of the day was what will become the complexion of the championship. Well, Al Unser Jr. has once again reasserted his presence after almost losing the championship, or at least letting Fittipaldi close. Now, there's no question, it's a battle within the Penske team, and we'll see whether or not Penske can set records throughout the remainder of the year. But still, despite the fact it's one team, tremendous competitors within that organization. Unser Jr., the winner today, Fittipaldi and Paul Tracy. I'm Paul Page. For Derek Daly, Jan Vikas, and Gary Cher-